In this video, I'll be talking about calibration in machine learning field. Basically, what is calibration and why do we even require calibration? You know, what are the behaviors of typical like traditional ML models, etc. Right? So without getting delayed, let's directly, you know, dive into the calibration. But just before that, let's get into a small quick question, right? So let's assume there are three classifiers. So the model A, which predicts 90% accuracy with the, you know, confidence of 0.85. Similarly, model B predicts 90% accuracy with the confidence of 0.91, and model C with 90% accuracy, but the confidence is way higher, that is 0.99, right? So when I say this confidence, you may think about this as a probability, so predicted probability, right? So the question is, which one of these models is better? You may pause the video and maybe take 10 seconds, like a minute, just ponder around that and see which answer would look best, okay? All right, so if you see the answer, right? So that is the model B that is having 90% accuracy with the, you know, confidence of 0.91, right? So there is, you know, basically the reason goes behind something like this. So when you consider the model A, it has 0.85 confidence. That means it thinks that it is 85% of the times correct, but it is actually 90% correct, right? So you may consider this as, you know, underconfident. It is not that much confident, right? So, but when you consider model C, it thinks that 98% times it is correct, but actually it is 90% correct, right? It is kind of, you know, overconfident model. So when you compare it to these two, model B, it's not even overconfident, or neither it is underconfident, right? So that's why the correct, you know, model, if someone asked you to pick up, that would be model B. So just be with me, just let's complete the presentation first. At the end of the day, I think you'll be able to know the reason behind this, right? So let's get into what is calibration. So the definition, so we all must have dealt with building of one or the other ML models, right? Either you could be using scikit-learn, or you might have used TensorFlow, PyTorch, or whatever it is. And most of the ML models, when you have used, you might have used some kind of probabilities, right? If you're using scikit-learn, for each of the data points, you will getting something called as probabilities, right? So for the calibration, some of the ML models will have some of the bias towards these predicted values, right? So the expected, you know, the distribution, the expected real distribution is, you know, it is different from whatever the predicted distribution, right? So whenever the predicted distribution, I think what I mean to say is the probabilities which has been predicted by the machine learning models. So we call this as a bias, right? So it could be, you know, positively biased, it could be negatively biased, right? So this bias in the predicted probabilities is what we call it as, you know, to fill this gap, we use something called calibration. So this is the definition of what the calibration is. Now, you know, let's look into why do you even require calibration at the first place, right? So, you know, in most of the applications, you know, we require probability scores along with the actual true class labels of the model, right? So we not only require the true class labels, but also we require corresponding probability values, right? We might need to fix the threshold, right? For those kind of applications, we might, you know, probability scores is required. And if the probability score is not that much accurate or it's not that much correct, then whatever the, you know, valuations you do on top of it, that will go for a toss. So maybe, you know, to get the correct values of a performance metric, what I mean by this is, let's assume that if you are using a performance metrics like log loss, or let's say a square error, so whatever it is, right? So let's consider the log loss. So when you consider the formula of log loss, obviously it has included probability values, right? So if the probability values is not calibrated, or if the probabilities are not correct, then whatever the matrices you get, that will also be not correct, right? then overall the performance which you give, which you assume that model would give, it might not perform that much in the production or in reality, right? So to basically, in simple words, why do you need to calibration is to remove the biases in the predicted probabilities given by the trained a machine learning model, whatever the model could be. So we discuss what is the calibration, then why we are required, right? But the question obviously arises, is it mandatory to apply calibration always, right? So in that way, the answer is absolutely no. So there is no hard rule saying that you need to apply calibration always, right? So no, if there is no compulsory, then let's look into cases like where we need to apply and where we need not to apply, right? So let's dig into when we even to apply calibration. So let's take the case of a imbalanced data set. Let's assume that the data set is very high much imbalanced. Let's say 1:99 or 2:99. Usually it occurs in finance or healthcare industry. So let's take the typical credit fraud protection, right? So 1:99, that means if you have 100 transaction, only one transaction could be, more, no, or what is it, labeled as a positive. That means fraud. 99% of them, it would be non-fraud, right? When you want to detect these kind of systems, obviously this is a very highly imbalanced data set, right? So now you might have done some kind of upscaling or downscaling in order to balance the data set so that our model, right? Whatever the model you think, ML model, either it could be logistic regression, naive Bayes, SVMs, or any forms of neural networks or vanilla or different forms of RNNs, whatever it is, right? So you think that balanced data set might work for these kind of models, and using some kind of upscaling and downscaling, you have balanced it up to an extent. Then you are trying the model and you got certain matrices, right? But if you take a step back and look what just happened, right? The real data set is 1:99. That's how it is imbalanced. Now, because of upscaling or downscaling you have done, maybe it could be like 40:60 or 45:50. That's how the imbalanced ratio drops down, right? So model right now, whatever the model you have trained, it don't see the imbalanced one. Right now, it sees the only one thing, that is the balanced data set which we have given, right? Even if you think about it, there is very highly biased, right? But in the real scenario, when you give the real data set, that data set will have the every imbalanced in nature, 1:99. It won't be 45 or 50:50 in nature, right? That's how the nature of the data set. Upscaling and downscaling, that is something which we have done, right? So I think you can able to observe this bias. So right, in order to eliminate this bias, obviously we need to apply calibration. So I think we discussed, I think few minutes back, regarding if a matrix involves probability values, something like log loss, obviously we need to apply matrices. So boosted trees, naive Bayes, these have the nature of the modeling in such a way that it would have some kind of bias towards the predicted probabilities. We all know that naive Bayes has a unrealistic assumption about the future, that is all futures are independent and all futures are normal in nature, right? So maybe due to this kind of assumption also, the predicted probabilities might not be in shape or might not be accurate, right? So also we draw something called as calibration plot, which we're gonna discuss in few minutes. So when we draw calibration plot, and if we see that calibration plot is not correct, then it's time to apply calibration. Now we know when to apply calibration, then let's see when need not to apply calibration, right? So whenever the underlying model is logistic regression or neural networks, so you need not apply any kind of calibration, right? So I will be providing the research paper on which the PPT has been designed. So that is from the Cornell Universities. So whatever the PPT which I'm doing, that is everything is based on the paper. I'll be providing the link of the paper in the description section of this video. So what these people have done is they have done like many experiments over 10 different data sets on, and they have used multiple algorithms, and this is what they found experimentally. that logistic regression and neural network, usually most of the times they predict well calibrated probabilities, right? And also whenever the calibration plot we draw is correct, then you need not apply calibration. So just in simple words, if you are using logistic regression or any form of neural network, right, either it could be vanilla form of neural networks or RNNs or various forms of RNNs, LSTMs, CNN, like whatever it is, whenever you try to use it, so need not apply. Of course, there are many exceptional for this, but this is very, very on a most of the times on a very, very high level, right? So now, you know, we have discussed about why do you require it, what about those things, right? Before getting too much about the calibration, let's discuss few of the behaviors of the ML models, right? So margin maximization method, something like, you know, SVM, right? Usually whenever we, you know, observe the probabilities values predicted from the SVMs, usually they are away from the zeros and ones. So when you draw a histogram of the SVM model, so when you see that there are very, very less values whose values, there are very, very less values whose values e closer to zero or one. What I mean to say is when you draw a histogram of predicted probabilities from the SVM model, where you will see very less values in the 0 and 1 region. That means the values greater than 0.9 or the values less than 0.1, it be very, very less. So similarly when you draw a histogram of predicted probabilities for the algorithms like naive Bayes, usually they will have more values towards zeros and ones. Or in other way, we can say that these kind of algorithms, they push the probabilities value towards the ends, that is towards the zeros and towards the one. So but other algorithms such as, you know, just like we discussed, neural networks or logistic regression, by default they would predict very, very well calibrated values, right? So, you know, when we are discussing, so I also mentioned that if a calibration plot is correct, then need not apply calibration. If it is not correct, then of course you may think about applying a calibration plot, right? So let's see how to draw a calibration plot. In simple words, it's the actual probabilities versus the predicted probabilities of any given ML model. Obviously, right, whenever you have built any kind of machine learning model, you would be getting the predicted probabilities. But how do you even get the actual probabilities, right? So that let's see how well we can calculate the approximate the actual probabilities and draw this calibration plot. First step is we have assumed that we have already trained machine learning model, right? What either it could be logistic regression or any kind of traditional methodology, or you might have used any kind of neural networks. And that is a first assumption. And second thing is, obviously, whenever you're trained, you must have used some kind of data set, right? We call it as a trained data set. So when we call it as a trained data set, we also have something called test data set, which we have never used for the training data set, right? So step one is take the test set, right? Then you take the predicted probability. That means you run the model whichever you have designed and get the values, especially the predicted probabilities, right? Once you get the predicted probabilities for each of the data point in the test set, sort it. You may sort it descending order or you may sort it in ascending order. Usually people prefer sorting in ascending order, right? Excuse me. So once you have sorted this, just take only these two values, that is the predicted probabilities and the true class labels. So I'll just take an example, like what exactly I mean to say here. So predicted Y probabilities, you know, these are the predicted probabilities of the from the given model using the test set for each of the given points, right? Similarly, you just need to look into the actual label, that is a true label, for each of the data point in set. So as you may observe here, these are all sorted ascending in nature. So this would be the step number one, right? Once you have sorted it, So step number two goes something like this. The take the table which you have done in the previous step and split into k slots. Or, you know, you may think slots as something like bins, right? That means if table contains, let's say, 10,000 rows, and if you want to split into 100 bins, then each of the bin would contain 100 entries, right? So here, slot one, I mean, I'm just taking an example, slot one contains 5 rows, right? Similarly, slot two, score slot k, right? Each of the slot contains 5 rows, right? Slot or bin. Both are one and the same, right? So let's get into step three. So just know in the step one, we have taken the predicted probabilities and sort it. And the next step, we have taken the, once we have sorted it, we have split into, you know, bins or slots. Once you split into sort, for each of the slots, what you need to do is you need to calculate something called as average predicted probabilities and the average true clause, right? That means let's take the slot one or bin one in the table which we are taking for an example, right? So if you take the predicted y probabilities and you take average of it, that is 0.03 plus 0.09 blah 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 up to 0.21 divided by 5, right? This is something which you would be getting, 0.12. Why 5? Because in this specific bin there are only 5 rows, right? And let's assume that we are, you know, all the probabilities values are, we are calculating for the label called 1, right? Let's assume 1 is a positive, right? That means 0.03 is the probability of this data point being positive. So, right, what I mean by 0.2 here is probability of this data point being positive is 0.2. That's how you may interpret this, right? Interpret it, sorry. So true label, so if you look into that, so fraction of 1 in this 5 is 1/5. That means if you take 5 rows, it occurs only one time. So 1 divided by 5, that is 0.2, right? So we need to calculate these calculations for each of the bins, right? If you have k bins, you will be having k pairs of average predicted y probabilities and average true labels, right? Once you have these, well, once you have these kind of pairs, that is k pairs, all you need to do is just plot it, right? So let's see how ideal calibration plot would look like, right? So these are the fraction of positives here, and these are the mean predicted values. These are the two values which are taken from the previous step, whatever the we have calculated so far. You know, if the model is very well calibrated, usually you would see a diagonal like something like this, right? This is the ideal calibration curve, right? Of course, every time you need not apply step 1, step 2, step 3. Obviously, we may take after the library. I think scikit-learn also has a library called calibration curve. You just need to provide the data set and you can able to get the k pairs of fraction of positives and then the mean predicted values, right? No, just look into what scikit-learn says about the probability calibration, right? So this is the calibration plot which I was talking about. So this is the whatever the dotted line you see here, that is the ideal calibration curve. Or this calibration curve is also, or plot is also called as reliability curve, right? People use interchangeably. And the y-axis is the fraction of positives, and x-axis is the mean predicted value, that is what are the mean predicted value for each of the bins which are calculated, right? So when you see here, the blue line is very close to the ideal calibration line or ideal calibration curve, right? So blue line is logistic regression, right? Let's see the green one, which is, you know, farther away from the ideal calibration curve, right? So it is very farther away, the green one, but blue one is very nearer. So when you look into the values, what exactly green and blue and other stuff, right? So blue is logistic regression and SVM is something is in green in color, right? So, you know, that's the region, you know, usually logistic regression. I think even if you draw for neural networks, you would be getting the similar kind of crop, right? So this is the reason why we say, you know, most of the time we would do logistic regression is well calibrated compared to other models, right? So, you know, even if you look into the histogram, right? So let's look into the histogram. Even if you see the graph, right, green one, green is support vector machines, right? So I was just explaining in few minutes back, you will see very few values around 0 and 1, but you will see more values between, you know, 0.2 to 0.8 and or in the middle range, right? Even if you see that the histogram, we see lot more values here. And this is exactly the opposite case in naive Bayes. I think you can just see the graph over here, right? So, and these are the extreme cases, right? And there are other cases which will happen between these two. That could be random forest, or it could be like, you know, naive Bayes, whatever it is, right? These are the other cases. Okay, let's, you know, get back to the presentation. Okay, now we have looked into what is a calibration plot and how we even draw it, right? So once we know when to apply calibration and how to draw a calibration curve, it's very important to know how to apply, right? What I mean by how to apply is there any methodology, existing methodology or existing algorithms using which you can able to apply calibration, right? So we may take, like, right now we don't have very famous two methods for this calibration. One is Platt calibration and another is isotonic regression, right? So let's get into Platt calibration. So these are the methods we know we can use in order to apply calibration for the ML models. So Platt is a, you know, he's a scientist. He worked majorly on SVM, right? So right now he's also working as a, I think, research scientist in Google. So he's worked a lot more on SVMs. So basically this calibration, we, you know, it would take the output from the support vector machines, SVMs, either it could be linear SVM or kernelized SVM, whatever the form, then it would, you know, it would try to predict the posterior probabilities, right? You know, it does that, you know, by passing the predicted probabilities from the SVM through a function called sigmoid, right? So it tries to minimize the log loss, right? So basically, whenever the data is less and the predicted probabilities in sigmoid in nature, this methodology would really work well, right? So let's see how exactly it tries to do that, right? So this is the formulation. That means, you know, we all know that 1 by 1 plus x, e raised to whatever the, we have it, right? So those is the typical formula for sigmoidal function. So now, you know, what are the F value you are seeing? Those are the predicted probabilities from the underlying model. In our case, it's an SVM, right? So we give the values, and A and B are the variables or the constant which we need to find, right? So obviously we will finding the values of A and B using our favorite gradient descent algorithm. So obviously gradient descent algorithm, it has to minimize loss, right? So gradient descent, it tries to make use of log loss to find the values of A and B, right? So the formulas goes something like this, right? So after several iterations, we would be getting the true values of A and B here, right? So these, you know, these points I have taken from the Cornell research. The credit goes to the Cornell education. They have, you know, they have published a paper. I have just taken this information from the said paper, right? You know, but one thing, you know, which you may ask or you may get surprised is, do you need to apply Platt's calibration of every time whenever you use cyclotron's SVM, right? For that, the answer is no. Because whenever you try to use cyclotron's probabilities, right, cyclotron SVMs, and especially to get the probability values, right, they are calibrated by default. That means in binary case, the probabilities are calibrated using Platt scaling. The Platt scaling, you know, you can also think like applying logistic regression on top of the SVM or on top of the values which has been predicted by the underlying predicted values, as in probability values predicted by the underlying machine learning model, right? So you may take it for granted that these are all well calibrated. Of course, you know, as you may see, Platts has also some theoretical issues. Of course, this would be there. But you, what I mean to say is, in short, is you need not apply explicitly Platts calibration if you are using SVMs from the scikit-learn. So that's what I think. Usually I mentioned that reading the documentation and understanding is very, very necessary, right? All right. So, you know, this is the formulations for Platts Platts calibration. Okay. Now let's look into what is the pros and cons of the Platts calibration. So as I was saying, it really works for the small data set, right? So let's define what is a small data set. If the data points which you are having is less than 1,000 data points, then we may call it as a small data set. Again, this definition comes from the research paper which I was studying here, right? And it works really, really well for the SVM kind of model, because whenever you try to draw a calibration plot, the plot looks something like sigmoidal in nature, sigmoidal curve, okay? But if the Platts calibration doesn't work, if the, you know, when you try to draw a calibration plot and if it is not in sigmoidal shape, it won't work very well, right? And you know, the basic assumption of the Platts is the calibration plot is something sigmoid in shape, right? And also we cannot expect every model to give probabilities in such way, right? So we, in other way, this Platts is something which is not generic in nature, right? It is very specific to SVMs, right? So in order to, you know, solve the problems, like something like it is not generic and it requires very small data set, and you know, these are the problems we have. In order to solve this, we have something called isotonic regression, right? You know, I was just, you know, pondering around why the name regression comes from, right? So when you think about this problem, right, you know, if we take a couple of steps back and just look at the problem, right, we have the predicted probabilities from the one of the, our machine learning model, right? Either it could be traditional ML models or it could be any kind of neural networks. All we need to do is, you know, we need to find the real probabilities values, or technically speaking, posterior probabilities values, right? So we have the predicted probability values and we need to map it to posterior one. So this mapping is also a kind of regression, right? These are the regression, these are the values which are continuous in nature and not discrete in nature, right? These are the probability values, right? So that's where the name regression comes from, right? So isotonic regression, right? You know, what it tries to do is, it tries to, you know, develop multiple linear models, right? On top of, you know, it will draw a calibration curve and it tries to, you know, find multiple linear models by splitting the curve into multiple chunks, right? In order to find the actual posterior probabilities, right? So this method is more general in nature. I was saying that these are the methodology we use in order to overcome the cons which we faced in Platts calibration. Let's see how exactly it works, right? These are just the jargons for time being. So let's assume that this is a, you know, I just taken random graph here. This is not a random graph. This is a typical calibration plot which we discussed. This is the mean predicted value and these are the fraction of positives, right? Let's assume that this is something which you had drawn using the whatever the methodology, step one, step two, step three, we had discussed, right? Calibration. We have followed those two methods on certain kind of data set, and this is the calibration plot which we got. Now, what isotonic regression tries to do is, it tries to find lines, something like L1, L2, L3, L4, using this calibration plot, right? So, you know, basically, though, on a high level, what it tries to do is, it tries to find something called boundary, that is A0, A1, A2, A3. Along with that, it also finds the line 1, L1, L2, L3, L4, right? Here I just take an example. So this, you know, this L1, this is need not be 4 or need not be 3. That is completely depends on how your calibration plot looks like, and that there are, like, you know, variations of algorithm where we can make it work, right? So, you know, the formula for a line goes something like y is equal to mx plus c. We need to find the y-intercept and also we need to find the slope, right? So in this case, for the example which you are showing, there are four lines. That means each of the line has two you know variables to find. That means we have 8 variables, and also we need to find boundary, right? A1, A2, A3, 8 plus 4, right? For this example, there are 12 variables we need to find. The values of those variables we need to find using the isotonic regression. Basically, isotonic regression, it tries to optimize in such a way that this should be values should be generated by that algorithm. So this is how isotonic regression works. This is the intuition behind how exactly it works, right? So once we have developed this model, let's say we want to calibrate. Okay, we have done with the calibration, we also done with the basic modeling, everything is done, right? Let's assume that we have put this model in production. Let's see how it works, right? So let's assume that there is a point which comes in. Let's assume that the values of the mean predicted value for that particular data points lies somewhere between A2 and A3, right? Or the mean predicted value, if the number of values are number much greater, or if it is a single value, it is a single number, right? Mean is only one. So let's assume that it lies between A2 and A3, right? So what you can do is, we can take the corresponding line, in this case it is L3, and you can apply the formula which is it has gone using the isotonic regression. You can get back the real values here, right? M of L3, that is M3 and C3. M3 and C3 would be the slope and constants of the L3 line, using which X is something, you know, predicted value, right? Using these three, we could able to get the real posterior probability, or in simple terms, fraction of positives, right? This is how isotonic regression works on a very, very high level. Obviously, this has also got few of the pros and cons. You know, it works for different models, obviously, right? It don't have any specifications like the plot saying that it has to be sigmoid in nature, or it don't have anything. It just works, right? And it works better than plots only when the data is large in nature, right? Fortunately, this is also one of the cons, right? And usually this methodology is very, very powerful than the plot. That is, isotonic regression is powerful than the plots one, but it needs lot more data than the plots one, obviously, right? Because it has lot more, you know, variables to find. As in case of, you know, plots, only when you have A and B, those are the values you need to find. But we have like so many lines and so many borders we need to do, right? Obviously, it need more data to get the training done. So this is what is a, you know, isotonic regression and a plot. Let's take one few of the takeaway from these two calibration methods, right? So isotonic regression outperforms plot whenever there is a more data, for the obvious reasons which I've been discussing. And calibration doesn't help back trees much. So people have done varieties of experiment using so many data, many, you know, data sets, also using various kinds of variations of the back tree, such as random forest. It seems that it has improved, but not that much, not up to an extent, or not that much satisfactory, right? It has helped, but not that much, right? So you can make consider it has not helped bag tree such as random forest to improve the calibration from the underlying machine learning model. In this case, it is random forest. That means if you apply calibration model on top of random forest, you might not be seeing the real posterior probabilities up to it. I think you won't be seeing the real probabilities values, right? You may be seeing only a deviation from the underlying machine learning model, right? In fact, as I was saying, neural networks and logistic regression, usually they give well-calibrated curve. On top of it, even if you try to apply calibration model, it hurts the performance, right? That means earlier there might not be any bias because of the calibration model which you have done. You are injecting the bias to the model, right? So again, these are all based on the experiments. I completely need to agree that it all depends on the kinds of data set and kinds of, you know, model which you are building. So this is on a most of the times, right? We cannot say that 100% of the times this works, right? So we can, you know, take a step back and say that most of the time these are the arguments, it will still stay true, right? You know, just take a quick summary of what we have been discussing, right? Neural networks and logistic regression, they predict very, very well calibrated most of the times, right? So how can you verify it? Just draw the calibration plot and you will come to know whether it is well calibrated or not. There are some other course as well, using which you can, you know, say that, hey, this is a well calibrated model or well not calibrated. There are like various ways. One such way is drawing the calibration plot, right? And for the Boosted Trees or Naive Bayes or SVM, for those kind of algorithms, those kind of models, if you apply calibration, we would be, you know, getting the best probabilities, right? The probabilities from the calibrated model will be posterior, or, you know, you may say that, you know, it's an approximation to the probabilities, right? Plat scaling, we also discussed plat scaling is more effective when the data smell is small, and also isotonic regression is more powerful. There is a difference between the effectiveness and the powerfulness of a model, right? If the data is small, and, you know, if the plat, no, the what you say, calibration curve is sigmoid in nature, you may go for plat scaling. And if a curve is not sigmoid and if you have a lot more data, then obviously you go for isotonic regression, right? So, you know, there are like several permutation combinations you can do, and most of the times isotonic regression would work really well because it don't have any certain specifications, like it has to be sigmoid or something, right? So, you know, whatever the calibration model we try, right, all we are trying to do is approximation to the real probability, the real posterior probability. We are not going to find the exact posterior probabilities, but we are going to find the approximation to the posterior probabilities. We are not trying to find the real probabilities. Okay. So I think we have also come to the end. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask in the comments. I will try to answer in few times, few days or whatever it is, right? Whenever I get free, I will try to answer it. So thank you so much for watching this video.